Before I start my sermon, I have to acknowledge, you know, you don't write a sermon in isolation. And I am really grateful. Many people helped with this sermon, especially because I needed a most unusual item, which all shall be revealed shortly. But I learned so much about so many of you who told me where I could find one of these items. But I especially want to thank the Stop Mass Incarceration Network folks who are helping with today. Again, before I start, I really believe that GLIDE is a global spiritual movement. And, you know, we've been sending folks away from this place to extend GLIDE's unconditional love, unconditional acceptance, especially through our Ray of Hope trips to Kenya. We also, yes, amen. We also, Pastor Theon's taking a group. Very excited about this, and you're going to be learning more to Mississippi to work it with areas that are still recovering from Katrina. Very important. We do this. We're not just a Taylor and Ellis. But one member of our Ray of Hope team I want to invite forward, Kirsty, come on up. Kirsty is, she is going to back to Nairobi to meet with, there's been some changes in the Ray of Hope community there, and so she's going to be checking to see how they're doing and how we can next send our next team. But you're also doing some other amazing things. You want to share?
Thank you. So I'll be meeting with the Ray of Hope team that we met with last year, as well as another larger Ray of Hope team that's farther north in Kenya, and working with them on their business plan and how they're becoming self-sustainable instead of depending on money that comes from donations, as well as a really lovely group of grandmothers who are raising their grandchildren because their children have died of AIDS, the parents have died of AIDS. And these grandmothers are selling their handy wares to pay to raise their grandchildren. So we're working with them to help them find a sustainable business plan so that they can raise their grandchildren. So thank you, congregation, for your support.
And we're going to offer her a prayer. So will you pray with us? Loving and generous God, we give thanks for Kirsty, for the witness, for the trip she will be making, for the way she will continue to build relationships between GLIDE and communities in Nairobi and throughout Kenya. We ask that you pour your spirit upon her, that she might be a listening, learning servant, as she offers her intellectual wisdom as well as the love in her heart and the labor of her hands to extend your love in the world. Bless her with safe travels, and we ask that everyone she meet, may they know something about this love, this acceptance that we know here. Amen. Blessings, blessings, blessings. And I just need to let you know something. I will be gone for several weeks. I just wanted to let you know. I have been accepted in a program in Oxford where I will be presenting a paper on GLIDE. So, and for those of you who are like, Oxford, so what? This will get you. I'll be eating 3 meals a day in Harry Potter's dining hall. I just thought, oh, now she's talking. Now she's talking. But before that, Robin and I are leaving, going to leave before the program starts because we're going to walk 102-mile Cotswold Way Trail. So we ask for your prayers as we go. Yeah. So lately, I have been caught up in the media frenzy around two people. One is a relative newcomer to the scene. The other has been around a while. The first is Baby Royal, and the second is Nelson Mandela. And I have to tell you, my mother is from Nova Scotia. Her family immigrated from England and Scotland, and so I have to tell you, Royal watching is in my DNA, okay? We watch what happens to the royals. I have drank from a Princess Diana teacup, and I have eaten off of Queen Elizabeth's face plate. So of course I joined in the watch for the newest member of the royal family, His Royal Highness Prince George of Cambridge. But you know, there's another somber watching going on as Nelson Mandela's life ebbs. A most remarkable man, made for a most remarkable time, who ushered in a new era of liberation and equality in his country. As I think of these two individuals, I can't help but stop thinking about the notion of prisons. Mandela, as we know, spent 27 years, more than a quarter of his life, in prison. And Prince George, even at the tender age of 6 days, has already entered a prison. It may be more posh than Mandela ever had, and it may have more luxuries than you and I could ever imagine. But make no mistake, Prince George is in a very public prison, one that cost the life of his grandmother, Diana. So I've been thinking a lot this week about prisons, the one we're placed in justly or unjustly by others, and the ones of our own making. Now, you gotta know, prisons are a relatively new idea, new way to deal with those behaviors and actions that have broken established social arrangements. Until 300 years ago, there was no such thing as mass incarceration like we know it. There were beatings, forced labor, and social ostracism was the payback for one's transgression and sins. But in the late 1700s, with the Enlightenment era, oh, they had a new idea. You know what the greatest thing could be, punishment? To take someone's liberty away for a period of time before they return to society. Now, in the U.S., this was coupled with a new nation's religious zeal, and so these places became known as penitentiaries, which has as its root word what? Penitence. Penitence. As in that time spent reflecting and seeking forgiveness for one's sins that was needed before one could return to society. For a long time, that model of incarceration as being penitent, of being corrected, of being reformed, held for a long time. But it always resulted, no matter what form it took, in overcrowding, filth, and dangerous conditions, which resulted in a focus on maintaining control over inmates rather than helping them return back to society. Punishment, once the means to the end of returning to society, became the means and the end, punishment for punishment's sake. Now in America, we can't help but look at the rise of the mass incarceration model with the rise of racial minorities as inmates. Brown and black people, once freed by the 13th Amendment, have been enslaved once again through our prison system. The U.S. has 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the world's prison population. Black and brown men are incarcerated at a rate 6 times that of whites. One in every 3 black men born today will spend part of their life behind bars. 2/3 of former inmates will return again to prison, something stinks with our current prison system. It is a nation's shame. I'll say it again. It is a nation's shame that we have written off a whole group of young men still in their prime. It is a nation's shame that there's not more outrage in our streets, in our political chambers, and in our churches. It is a nation's shame that we spend only $10,000 a year to educate a young person, but are willing to spend $32,000 to imprison them. And I gotta tell you, in our state of California, it's even worse. We spend only $7,500 a year to provide someone with a college education, yet we are willing to spend $48,000 a year to imprison someone. Do you know, if we emptied our prisons and gave every inmate a college education, we would save this state $7 billion a year. Thank God there are people willing to challenge the system, both inside and outside prison walls. We have members today here with us of Stop Mass Incarceration Network, and they will, yes, give amen. They will be downstairs in Freedom Hall after celebration. They are working in solidarity with inmates, particularly those at Pelican Bay, who are doing a rolling hunger strike to protest prison conditions. They have five basic demands: better food, expanding constructive programs, ending group punishment, ending debriefing, and ending long-term solitary confinement. And how timely is this? Because just yesterday, a man died in solitary confinement in a California prison. Go downstairs, learn more. As I pondered this sermon and wondered, why is it that we have allowed prisons not only to flourish, but we, you and I, have allowed them to become privatized so that there is an economic interest to imprison people? And I realized something. You can't work for another person's freedom successfully if you yourself are not free. And I have to tell you, there are an awful lot of us around here who are not free. There are systems and there are institutions that imprison us. There are stereotypes, and there are attitudes of others that imprison us. But worst of all, are the prisons we put ourselves in. While systems and stereotypes do imprison us, far more dangerous are the prisons that we place ourselves in. When we honestly look at ourselves and the world, we realize that we can blame others all we want, but it's our addictive behaviors that have put us in here. We can bemoan how folks have failed us, but it's our self-defeating behaviors that have put us in here. We can point to others who have one up on us all we want, but it is in fact the choice we make or fail to make the actions we take or fail to take that keep us imprisoned. There was once a young, wealthy man. He was a power broker. He was a real player who got wind of a new sensation. A man who was making all sorts of news because he was saying the most radical stuff about how you could live a richer, fuller life than we thought possible. And this guy, this rich young man, was finding his life pretty meaningless. And he was determined to find this motivational speaker. And find him he did, surrounded by all sorts of people. But this guy was used to getting what he wanted. He was used to pushing people out of the way, and so he pushed everyone out of the crowd and got close to the speaker, and he said, "What can I do? What can I do to have this life that you're talking about?" And Jesus told him it was simple. Don't murder. Don't commit adultery. Don't lie. Honor your mother and father, and love your neighbor as yourself. The young man said, "I've done all that, but I still feel so empty." And Jesus told him this: "Go sell your possessions." And that's exactly what the young man said, because he knew what was coming. Go sell everything you have and give everything to the poor. You will possess a new kind of wealth. Just watch me do it. Just follow me. The rich young man was stunned to hear these words. Stunned. And he had to turn away. Crestfallen. You see, he was holding on tight to a lot of things, and he couldn't let them go. And that grip put him in a prison that stifled his spirit. Material things became his prison. An unquenchable thirst for the newest, the biggest, the best that had never left him feeling satisfied. What is your prison? What has caused you to create a prison of your own making? How badly do you want your freedom? You know, the men at Pelican Bay are freer than most of us. They may be locked behind doors, but they aren't willing to imprison their spirits. They know that if they give in and accept the inhumane conditions and harsh treatment of Pelican Bay, then they will be in prison. As long as they're working to improve their living conditions, standing up, speaking out for better treatment, they are freer than most of us who accept things as they are and assume that they will always be that way. And here's what the rich young man didn't understand. Because he couldn't leave the prison his love of possessions put him in, he cut himself off from others. This self-imposed prison always winds up keeping people on the outside rather than side by side. We wind up in our own solitary confinement, seeking to let go of those things that imprison us. Always draws us more deeply into community. When we seek our own freedom, we always wind up with deeper connections with others, and we desire their freedom as well. Nelson Mandela, in talking about his 27 years in prison, put it this way: it was during those long and lonely years that my hunger for my own people became a hunger for all people, freedom for all people, black and white. I knew, as well as I knew anything, that the oppressor must be liberated just as surely as the oppressed. Yes. A man who takes away another man's freedom is a prisoner of hatred, as long as he is locked behind the bars of prejudice and narrow-mindedness. I am not truly free if I am taking away someone else's freedom, just as surely as I am not free when my freedom is taken from me. The oppressed and the oppressor alike are robbed of their humanity. As he approached the end of his time in prison, Mandela learned an important lesson that we all must learn if we are going to break out of our cells and be free. It's a lesson similar to the one that rich young man couldn't grasp. He said this: as I walked out the door toward the gate that would lead to my freedom, I knew that if I didn't leave my bitterness and hatred behind, I'd still be in prison. I'd still be in prison. It's time to get out of your prison. It is time to let go of victimhood. It is time to let go of bitterness. It is time to let go of hatred. It is time to let go of self-defeating behaviors. It's time to let go of materialism, of anger, of selfishness. It's time to let go of whatever has ensnared you, that has put you in prison. It is time to let your soul be free. Amen.